Hello, my name is Bill Aaron, Director of Training at Engineered Corrosion Solutions. We'd like to thank you for taking time out of your schedule to be with us today. We'd also like to thank Orr Protection for allowing us to be part of their Mission Critical Fire Protection Virtual Conference. In this session, we'll be discussing corrosion management of fire sprinkler systems for cold storage applications. Our objectives are to maintain an operational fire sprinkler system in a refrigerated space. That includes protect against corrosion between the sprinkler riser and the refrigerated space, eliminate ice and frost accumulation in the refrigerated space, reducing the maintenance and operational costs, as well as extending the system life cycle. Our industry guidelines are NFPA 13, the standard for installation of fire sprinkler systems, NFPA 25, the standard for inspection, testing, and maintenance of water-based fire sprinkler systems, and FM Global's data sheet 8.29, the FM Global Property Laws Prevention for Refrigerated Storage. There are currently three technologies that are available today. One is dry air packs, one is nitrogen-based, and the third is vacuum-based. We're going to primarily be talking about dry air packs and nitrogen-based. Vacuum-based is a rather new technology. There's not a lot of information out there yet, but we at least want to let you be aware that it is available. First of all, our concerns. You know, according to FM Global's data sheet, based on their field examinations, they're finding ice plugs in over 50% of the freezers they've examined. And those ice plugs are generally found within the first 15 feet of the pipe inside the cold storage area. So these are the things that we're concerned about and they're concerned about, and we want to try to mitigate this. Also, from an operational standpoint, there's concerns regarding oxygen corrosion between the valve trim and the refrigerated space. So we're talking about the valve itself, the trim work, and the mains between the riser and the refrigerated space. What can happen hydraulically? It can impair the sprinkler system due to the corrosion byproducts. It could plug the sprinklers and or it could cause an accidental discharge due to corrosion on the trim components. So first of all, let's start talking about what are the requirements for refrigerated space. And NFPA 13 tells us when the temperatures maintain above 32 degrees, the requirements for this section do not need to be applied. So what they're saying is that below 32 degrees, you need to follow this section of the code. And the reason for this section is to minimize ice plug formation in the sprinkler systems. Now, you can use one of two supplies according to NFPA 13. You can either use air or you can use nitrogen. If you're using air, then the air must come from the room with the lowest temperature to reduce the moisture content. You can also use a compressor dry air package that's listed for the application, and if you do that, then you can use ambient air, or you can use compressed nitrogen gas from cylinders in lieu of the compressed air. You know, there's a couple of things you need to remember. Just because you're taking the air from the coldest room does not guarantee that it's going to be moisture free. You can get a higher degree of prevention if that dew point of the gas is 20 degrees below that lowest nominal temperature. So as an example, if your freezer is operating at minus 20 degrees Fahrenheit, then to get you that higher degree of prevention, your gas needs to be at minus 40, 20 degrees below that. Now, if you're using air, there's a couple of things you need to know. Number one, in an air supply, you need to have two sources of supply into that sprinkler system. Those sources need to be, the two supplies need to be at least 6 feet long, and they need to be easily removed. And this is so you can inspect them to verify the system's operational. However, if you're working with nitrogen, you only need a single supply. The other thing to remember is, if you're working with valves that require priming water on that valve to hold it, to seal it, that priming water can evaporate and it can migrate into that freezer. So that could be an issue causing ice plugs. The other thing, if you have a compressor that runs a lot due to leaks in that system, that excessive running can also create more moisture that can compound your potential for ice plugs and frost accumulation. Now, here's how we're using NFPA 13 to allow us to use a nitrogen generator in lieu of the nitrogen cylinders that they list in their document. NFPA 13 says, where the term air is used throughout this standard, it shall include the use of nitrogen or other approved gas. Where nitrogen or other approved gas is used, the supply shall come from a reliable source. And the nitrogen or other approved gas can either be generated on site from storage containers sized to provide a reliable supply for at least 6 months of expected use. So that's allowing us to use a nitrogen generator in lieu of the nitrogen cylinders. Number two. You know, NFPA requires we have to get that system operational within 30 minutes. However, when you're working with facilities or refrigerated spaces that are below 5 degrees, minus 15 C, then they will allow us to extend that from 30 minutes to 60 minutes. The reasoning behind that is that if the gas is coming in slower, you reduce the potential for moisture content in that gas and thereby minimizing ice plugs within your sprinkler system. Now, NFPA 25, from an inspection standpoint, give us a list of all the things we need to look at for our sprinkler systems. The biggest one, when it applies to cold storage, is loading of the sprinkler, where you get an ice accumulation around that sprinkler head. And what they're telling us is, if you're running into situations such as loading that is detrimental to the sprinkler performance, or if it's severely corroded, then it should be listed as a deficiency or an impairment, and it needs to be designated as to be replaced. So if you run into those where you've got loading on those sprinkler heads or corrosion, they need to be replaced. Also, you know, tests have shown that the loss of the color in the glass bulb in these sprinkler heads does not affect the sprinkler. So even though the color's been lost, you are allowed to let it remain in service. NFPA 25 is also telling us that if you're operating the building, the interior of the building is at temperatures at or below 40 degrees, they shall not be wet. So anything below 40 degrees has to be a dry system. And when you're using air dryers, they shall be maintained in accordance with manufacturer's instructions, along with making sure that your compressor is used in conjunction with it, is test inspected according to Chapter 13 of NFPA 25. NFPA 25 is also requiring that we inspect the gauges near the compressor and compare them to the gauges on the sprinkler system. And this needs to be done on a monthly basis. This is to ensure that you don't have a freeze up in that supply line between your gas source, the compressor, and into the sprinkler system. Any valves need to be trip tested, and they be done in a way that we do not introduce moisture into the freezers whether they be a pre-action system or a dry system. As for ice obstruction investigations, they need to be inspected on an annual basis to make sure there's no ice obstructions where the piping enters the refrigerated area. If ice obstructions are found, then additional piping needs to be examined. We want to ensure that the sprinkler system is operational at all times. FM Global's data sheet also has requirements for refrigerated storage spaces. Their requirements in the refrigerated spaces, they are requiring that you use a dehydrated dryer or refrigerated air dryer that is FM approved and maintained in accordance with the manufacturer's instruction. It needs to be adequately sized. In turn, FM Global is requiring that the air supply be 20 degrees below the lowest nominal temperature. Then that air source needs to be taken from the freezer with the lowest temperature. And you need to have two separate lines as far as getting the air into the freezer. In addition, they're also requiring an additional check valve between the valve assembly and the discharge line to ensure we don't have moisture migration into the sprinkler system. When a system trips, after it trips, you need to inspect the entire system. And if ice plugs are found, you need to disassemble it, the entire system, and move it to a warm area to let it unthaw naturally. You're not allowed to use heaters. You're not allowed to use torches. You have to let it unthaw completely naturally. Now, as far as comparing using dry air packs on dry systems, currently there are three different models that are available. There's a 500 gallon capacity system, there's a 1,000, and there's a 2,000 gallon capacity system. For the manufacturer's recommendations, they limit three sprinkler systems per dry air pack. What we've found is that using dry air packs, they have demonstrated a history of ice accumulation. Their operating dew point, according to their current installation manual, is minus 40 to minus 60 degrees Fahrenheit. In an earlier version of the manual, it was minus 40 degrees. From a setup, from an operational standpoint, using dry air packs is very cumbersome. You know, when you first set it up, you have to let the dryer run. Currently, you let it run for a half hour before you connect it to the sprinkler system. In earlier versions of the manual, it was you had to let it run for 8 hours before you connected it to the sprinkler system. And of course, if there was any water in the pipe, you need to run a test and let it run for 24 hours before you went through the process. From an operational standpoint, the dryer operates on 4-minute cycles. You have to adjust the dryer so that it doesn't run for more than 40 minutes per hour and no more than 4 times per hour. From a maintenance standpoint, you've got to change the oil in the compressor every 750 hours of runtime. You got to inspect the desiccant annually and make sure that it's firm and white. You got to replace the desiccant every 3 years. You know, this is in their current manual. Their previous manual said you had to replace it every 1 to 2 years. You have to, and when you do that, you got to replace the filters and the oil in the compressor. And of course, when you replace a desiccant, then you've got to go through the initial setup again, which is run the dryer for a half hour before connect to the sprinkler system. And you have to remove the purging filters as part of this process. You know, in the earlier versions, it indicated previously run it for 8 hours, remove the mufflers during the first 2, and then reinstall. And then you've got to clean the purging mufflers periodically if either one of the regenerative towers is showing a pressure above 0. So they're very cumbersome as far as maintaining and operating the units. you know, here's some interesting things. You know, prior to 2018 with this, there was weekly, monthly, quarterly, and annual inspections and maintenance that needed to be done. After 2018, quarterly, annual, and now every 3 years. Not exactly sure why, but that's currently what's going on with dry air packs. Now, from a corrosion standpoint, I'd like to make some comparisons between dry air packs and using nitrogen. And we're going to use some of the same information. Okay, so here's our example. We've got sustained corrosion activity in a 1,000-gallon sprinkler system. And we're going to use NFPA's 13's allowable 1.5 PSI and 24-hour leak. So using a dry air pack, which puts oxygen into that sprinkler system, with a 1.5 PSI and 24-hour leak, you're going to introduce 21.3 gallons of oxygen into that system each day. And that 21.3 gallons of oxygen, the oxygen molecules are going to create 0.84 pounds of iron oxide. This is the oxygen dissolving in the water, removing steel out of that pipe. Now, a nitrogen system, which is operating at 98% purity, using the same criteria, the NFPA 13, 1.5 PSI and 24-hour leak, is only going to produce 2.01 gallons of oxygen. And that oxygen is going to create 0.08 pounds of iron oxide. So just from a corrosion standpoint, the dry air pack is going to result in 950% more corrosion during sustained operation. Now I want to look at using nitrogen for dry systems. First of all, nitrogen is a very dry gas. You know, the operating dew point of nitrogen is between minus 70 degrees and minus 100 degrees at 98%. As far as how many systems you can connect to a nitrogen generator, well, that really depends on the size of the sprinkler systems. In our example, if we had 1,000-gallon sprinkler systems, we could connect 22 1,000-gallon systems to our largest nitrogen generator, because our largest nitrogen generator can support up to 22,500 gallons of system capacity. So you've got a lot more variance with using nitrogen as far as the amount of equipment that you need. Based on our research and our case studies, we have found no ice accumulation when we've used nitrogen in cold storage applications. So now let's look at it from initial setup and operational and maintenance. Initial setup is connect electricity to it. Plumb the air compressor to the nitrogen generator and plumb the generator to each of the sprinkler systems served and set your operating pressure. From an operational standpoint, you open the vent. After 14 days, you close it. If you're using a manual vent, it's a manual function. If it's you're using a smart vent, you push the button and it does it for you. From maintenance, you've got to change the filters in the generator on an annual basis. And like any other air compressor, you need to change the oil every 500 hours. So when you start looking at the comparisons between cold storage, dry air packs and nitrogen, there's a lot less maintenance involved in a nitrogen generator. And no matter what the equipment is, if you don't maintain it right, it's not going to work right. And if it doesn't work right, your end result is going to be ice accumulation and frost in your sprinkler system, which is an impaired sprinkler system. So when you start comparing the two side by side, you know, dry air packs is using compressed air. Their dew point is between minus 40 and minus 60. It's a fluctuating dew point. And it's really, truly maintenance dependent. Ice plugs are possible. And because you're working with oxygen, there is no corrosion protection. Maintenance is extensive. You got quarterly, annual procedures. You got to replace a desk in every 3 years. And you're limited to the number of sprinkler systems that are connected to it, limited to three. You know, from an energy standpoint, dry air packs are always using energy, because the way that dry air pack works is that they run the air through one desk and tower, and they transition over to the second desk and tower after it runs for so long. And while it's going through the second desk and tower, it's drying out the desk and in the first tower. So it's transitioning back and forth. Nitrogen generator, especially ECS's nitrogen generator, uses membrane separation. There's no moving parts in it. We're just forcing the air through it, separating the oxygen molecules, and we have nitrogen. The nitrogen is at 98%. The dew point is -70 to -100. It is a consistent dew point. We know that it eliminates ice plugs, and we know because we're using nitrogen, we eliminate corrosion. Maintenance is minimal. We only have annual procedures. And the amount of sprinkler systems that you can connect to a nitrogen generator is totally based on the total system capacity of all of the sprinkler systems. Remember, our largest nitrogen generator can handle as much as 22,500 gallons. So here's a couple of case studies for us. The first one is a cold storage facility. It was kept at -10 degrees Fahrenheit. It was a single pre-action system, and the supervisor gas was being provided by a dry air pack, and they were doing quarterly inspections. The problem they were running into is frost and ice plugs were consistently being found during these quarterly inspections. So the dry air pack was removed, and it was replaced with a nitrogen generator. Since that time, and this was done in September of 2017, they have found no ice plugs and no frost accumulation in all of the subsequent quarterly inspections. Here's another one. It was a cold storage facility over 1 million square feet. The supervisor gas was provided by 8 dry air packs. They were doing annual inspections. Same thing. They were finding frost and ice accumulation was consistently being found. And the maintenance on these dry air packs was becoming cumbersome and costly. So what they did was they did a test, and they replaced 4 of the 8 dry air packs with a single nitrogen generator so they could compare the two. The results were that there was no ice accumulation in all the subsequent annual inspections. And this was completed in May of 2016. They have since gone back and removed those other 4 dry air packs and added them to the nitrogen generator. So what we've been able to prove is that by using nitrogen, which is a dry gas, we can mitigate ice plugs in cold storage applications, as well as mitigating corrosion in the piping between the valve and the cold storage facility. So what have we learned in this session? Number one, based on field examinations, 50% of the existing freezers have ice plugs. And this is per FM Global's data sheet. NFPA 13 and FM Global have specific requirements for refrigerated spaces where the temperatures are below 32 degrees. And this is to minimize ice plugs. NFPA 25 requires that piping in or passing through refrigerated spaces below 32 degrees must be inspected on an annual basis. And this is for obstruction, ice obstructions. If you're using dry air packs, they require quarterly and annual maintenance, and they recommend a maximum of 3 systems connected to a single unit. You know, and that's based on the volume of those units, either 500, 1,000, or 2,000 gallons. So what they're saying is a maximum of 6,000 gallons of system capacity divided by 3 systems to a single unit. When you're working with a nitrogen generator, it only requires annual maintenance. It's compatible with new and existing systems. And a single nitrogen generator can serve as much as 22,500 gallons of system capacity. And it really doesn't matter how many systems, as long as the total volume is less than that 22,500 gallons. Using nitrogen in refrigerated spaces eliminates ice plugs. We've been doing this research. We have the case studies and prove that it does. I hope this is beneficial to you, and we really appreciate you taking time out of your schedule to be with us. If you have any questions, please let us know. You can call us at 314-432-1377, or you can go to our website at ecscorrosion.com. There's a resources tab. Under that resources, there are case studies, white papers, a lot of information to help you. In addition, ECS has established a training program through ECS University to help people become an expert in corrosion and fire sprinkler systems. If you or anyone you know would be interested in becoming an expert, learning more, please go to the ECS University tab on our website and sign up. Again, I thank you. Let us know if we can help you out.